Okay, it looks like we are live. So you guys have to let me know in the comments down below where you guys are from. Our goal today is to get every single province in Canada on the map in the first 5 minutes. Saskatchewan, just so you know, you're usually last to come. That's okay though. I know Ontario is going to be first. Toronto or Ottawa? That's going to be the first ones in the comments to show up. Who's excited about doing Bokashi? First of all, who's heard of Bokashi composting before? I'd be interested to know that. This is like the Canadian way to compost because we don't have to deal with frozen compost piles outdoors, which is always a nice thing. Zone 3B in Ontario. Me and you, friend, share the same zone. It's a cold one, isn't it? It's minus 30 tonight here in Saskatchewan. This morning when I woke up, it was minus 22. That's just crazy. That's crazy cold. It's supposed to warm up next week, though. It's supposed to go to plus one. So that's very, very nice. My winter sown milk jugs outdoors will definitely appreciate that. I just have, who knows what winter sowing is? You have to let me know in the comments down below. But I have my milk jugs outdoors with like my peat moss, my seeds, all that stuff. They're all nicely duct taped up, sitting in the sunshine, frozen like a skating rink. No action to bed today. We have Alberta and we have Edmonton. Nova Scotia is here. The Maritimes popped in early this time. Usually you guys take a little while to get in the comments. Manitoba. Saskatchewan's gonna be last again. You just wait. Anyone from BC? We haven't gotten anyone from the territories yet. Regina. There we go. Regina beat BC this time. Saskatchewan beat BC. That's awesome. How about US? Anyone from the US? Usually we get Gatineau, Quebec. There we go. We got Quebec on the map now. Do we have any Americans? Usually we have a couple Americans show up as well. But you guys have to let me know if you have heard of Bokashi composting or give this video a bunch of thumbs up. Maybe hit the heart button a couple times if you're excited about learning about Bokashi composting. I'm gonna screw that up so many times tonight. And we're literally going from start to finish when it comes to Bokashi composting, but you will hear me several times talk about the actual product that you can use. However, if you stick around for our live at the end of March, I'm actually going to show you how to make this stuff so you don't have to buy it. So that's something that you're Pittsburgh, Colorado, there's our Americans. How are you guys doing today? Okay. Summerland, BC. There we go. We got BC on the map now. We're just missing the territories, New Brunswick and PEI. Ann Arbor, USA. That's such a pretty city name. Okay, I'm gonna get started, but you guys keep on letting us know West Watsontown, PA. Keep on letting us know where you're from in the comments, and then also let us know where if you've heard of Bokashi composting before. So I think the best way to start this all off is exactly what is Bokashi compost and what makes it different than that of a regular compost pile or something like a Vera compost. And the answer to that actually is pretty simple. Bokashi composting is using fermentation. So it's essentially pickling your compost or your organic material. And what ends up happening is it can be done in buckets indoors, and it's very quickly decomposed when it is placed in the soil. So with a traditional compost, we have to make sure we have equal parts of browns and greens. So our carbon to nitrogen ratio is very specific. We want to be very careful with that to ensure proper levels of decomposition. We also need to fluff and aerate, track our temperatures, that sort of thing when it comes to traditional compost. With Vera compost, we can feed all organic stuff, a wide variety of paper products, but we can't compost anything that has vegetable oils, dairy products, that sort of thing. We can't use that in a vermicompost system, because the worms simply just will not eat that, as well as lemons and limes. And there's certain things, potato peels, for example, worms generally just won't touch or won't eat and can slightly affect the pH. However, Bokashi composting was specifically designed for those urban dwellers such as ourselves. And it was developed over in Asia, and now it's been brought over here to Canada. And it means you can use or compost practically anything you desire, including in some cases, small animal bones like fish or chicken. Small quantities of meat can be composted in this, as well as obviously limes, lemons, potato peels, things that you typically wouldn't compost. There are cases where people, if they have birds or rabbits, maybe cats, cat litter, that sort of thing, that can also be composted in the Bokashi system. So it's kind of able to decompose everything. So the next question would be, well, why can it decompose everything? You guys have to let me know in the comments down below if you know why the answer is, but there's this specialty product in there called EMF bacteria or EMF product. And essentially what that is it's a combination of different microbes, all of which decompose organic material without the presence of oxygen. So what it is mostly is lactobacillus, which is the main proponent of what makes up Bokashi, but a lot of different brands claim to have different mixtures. So for example, this one that I have here beside me is the My Good Green. This is a Canadian company. You can get this over on Amazon, and I'm sure they sell it in stores too. I actually think I saw it at Canadian Tire. And this is the Bokashi Plus. Now, this is just the regular compost system, Bokashi Plus, but there is also an animal or a pet formula that can be used to actually compost waste from your dogs, your cats, rabbits, birds, that sort of thing. Or if you're just wanting to keep the smell down in the litter box, actually mixing in the Bokashi pet kit will also help. Now, for the most part, the animal kit won't differ, as far as I know, in regards to microbes between the two. And like I said, end of March, we have another live coming up. It's called the Compost DIY Compost Accelerator course. We're going to do another workshop where we're actually going to make this product, and we're going to make a lot of this product, because the more you use, the better results you will see. And we're going to do it from scratch. So today we're just going to do the bucket. Next video, we're going to show how to make this from scratch. And like I said, you can use this in the garden as a mulch, incorporate it into your potted plants. You can use this with houseplants. You can use it for the Bokashi composting, pets, you name it. Anywhere where you need decomposition or you need nutrient cycling to take place, the Bokashi bran is what it's also called, will work out great for you. So this stuff here, what it looks like is it reminds me of my birds. I have a parrot, and it reminds me of her litter, kind of like what I put in the container. So it looks actually like cornmeal now that I look at it a little bit closer, and it kind of smells like an acid or a vinegar. And the consistency or the fine grain of this will depend on the product you get. Generally speaking, the finer the product, the better, because that means more surface area, and more surface area means more interaction spaces where bacteria can hang out, and you get obviously more bacteria, or a fancy word for it is what we like to call colony forming units. We get more CFUs per space. So the finer the product, the better. Some will be kind of almost like an oatmeal flake, but for the most part, it should be relatively ground up. So this is the product I've been using. And I like it. It works very, very nicely, but it can get expensive. So this bag runs me $15 a bag, and you need to use, like I said, the more you use, the better. So we have some questions. I'm going to get to some questions, and then I'm going to move over on to how to do this. I don't like them to build up too much, but Michael over on Facebook from Zone 3B, Thunder Bay, Ontario. Are you able to use Green Earth Compost Accelerator Canadian Tire in the Bokashi composter using spent brewer grains as a Bokashi substrate and green food waste shredded cardboard and newspaper. So that actually, Michael, I got your question earlier today from Lee Valley. And so I looked up that product, Green Earth Compost Accelerator, and I can't tell what's in it. So it is an organic form. It's very clearly a microbe-based decomposer. I just don't know if it has anaerobic or aerobic bacteria in it. So what you would want to do is reach out to the company and ask if it's anaerobic or aerobic bacteria. If you're doing a Bokashi system, which you're going to learn here in a little bit, and or which you may already know actually, is it has to be pretty airtight. We don't want oxygen. So that means it's an anaerobic environment. So we need bacteria that thrives without oxygen present. So whenever you're looking for brands like this, if it doesn't state Bokashi on it and it just says compost accelerator or microbe booster, compost booster, just make sure it's an anaerobic product or the microorganisms in it are anaerobic, because we're about to completely seal that food off from any presence of oxygen. So that's something to keep in mind there. As for spent brewery grains, yes, that is a viable substrate to use as a carrier for your Bokashi mix, your EMF liquid, if you're buying actual EMF liquid, or if you're starting from scratch with the rice wash, etc. and so forth, which we'll do the video on next time. So yes, if you're using that as your substrate, you can. Just keep in mind that you need to dry it prior to inoculating it. So if it's already moist, we want to lay it out on, you know, a piece of cardboard, whatever the case is, and let it dry out before we inoculate, because we can't inoculate something with the liquid, the EMF liquid, if you're using it from the start, the get-go. You can't inoculate something that's already fully saturated. So just keep that in mind. So 1010 on Twitch is asking, can you compost meat? Yes. So the Bokashi, compost group, there's a few different modalities here, but for the most part, yes, you can compost meat. The biggest key is to make sure you don't allow too much liquid in the system. So I wouldn't like compost gravy, for example, or I wouldn't compost like a stew with all the juice. You could compost just the chicken meat or the chicken bones. Red meat's a little harder to decompose. And if you can shred it or make it into a finer product, that's going to decompose better. And that's a general rule with any sort of decomposing or just any composting. So if you can shred it or make it smaller in any way, then that's always better for us. So keep the questions coming though. I will be sure to answer all of them as they head my direction. So when it comes to the actual bucket, I want to get this out of the way because I know me and I know that I will bump this bucket at some point and this poor gamma lid's going to just go flying across the room. So I'm going to get this out of the way first. So when I initially started composting, Bokashi composting, I used your very classic 5-gallon pail lid. But then I met the wonderful people at Lee Valley Tools and I showed them photos of my system that I have in my basement. It's a 2-bucket system. So I have 2 5-gallon pails and I rotate between the two. They have the tap, but it's just a regular 5-gallon pail lid. It has the seal, it's completely sealed. And what I would do is I would fill up a separate Rubbermaid with food throughout, you know, day or two. And then I would go into the basement and I would sit there with a flathead screwdriver and I would peel off my gamma lid without this. And I would fill it up, put my Bokashis on, pack it down, and then put my lid back on and seal it. But I would only do it every 3 days because it was a huge pain in the butt to actually get into the bucket. So Lee Valley, thank you for this. I went and showed them what I was using and they're like, oh no, you don't have to use that at all. We have these wonderful lids called gamma sealed lids. So this is the ring, this is the top. You simply put it together when you initially snap it onto the bucket lid and you push hard. And this seal here is going to ensure a flawless seal where no oxygen is going to get into place. And then all you do is you literally spin this on. This is gonna sound loud on the mic, I think, but you spin this on and voila. You have a lid that is completely sealed, and then it is incredibly convenient to actually remove this and put your compost in. So that my Rubbermaid is officially going in the garbage. I ended up buying like three of these because sometimes talk to the professionals, guys. Don't try to make it up as you go. So this is an awesome product, and they do sell this online. And they do sell it also in store. So the gamma sealed lid, perfect, perfect bucket lid. And like I said, it's airtight. We have Louise from Prince Albert. Hello, Louise. Is it incredibly cold there like it is in Saskatoon? It's pretty chilly. So the next step is getting a 5-gallon pail bucket. So I just literally have been using the Lee Valley bucket is exactly what I'm using. I've used Home Depot buckets. There's wine making. You can get 5-gallon buckets. You don't even need a 5-gallon pail bucket if you don't think that your family is going to eat or produce that much compost. But once you start figuring out that you can put everything in a Bokashi bucket, you'll realize a 5-gallon bucket is the minimum you're likely going to want to get. I have a family of two, myself and my husband, and then my dogs and cats and parrot. We fill up a 5-gallon bucket and no issues whatsoever. So the system that you want to run is you want to have enough buckets to keep you going for 14 days. So it takes 2 weeks, 10 to 14 days for the entire container to ferment. So from the time you seal a bucket, you need it to sit for 14 days. So two bucket system works in my house. You fill a bucket, the bucket waits for 14 days, and then you empty out the old one and you start with a new one. When you go to empty your buckets in the winter time, you can either throw them directly on top of the snow. The critters don't touch this stuff because it's literally pickled and fermented, and they'll probably get slightly intoxicated from it. So, but I find that they don't touch it. I used to have issues with mice with my regular compost. They like the eggshells, they like that sort of thing. But with this, they tend to not touch it. If you wanted to, you could also get a larger sized Rubbermaid, which is what I'm doing currently, just the really big ones. And then you would just dump your Bokashi in there every 2 weeks, and you would just fill it up and seal it. By the time the end of the 2 weeks, a majority of the liquid that would be drained off of your Bokashi is gonna be gone, so long as you're not introducing too much liquid as you're composting. So that's what you wanna do there. Two bucket system works for me. Some of you may need three, four, whatever the case is. So next, you want to drill a hole. So I pre-drilled this because I'm an incredibly klutzy human being. And while you would have enjoyed it, my ego wouldn't have. So what you want to get is you want to get a stepper bit. This is what I used for this. Or at a minimum, you need a drill bit that will fit this barrel tap. So this is also from Lee Valley Tools. The ones I used in the past, which I actually do not like compared to this, is water tank heaters. They have kind of similar to this, but it doesn't come down. It actually just kind of goes straight out almost. If you know what I'm talking about, you know what I'm talking about. This is much nicer, this barrel tap, where it comes out and it goes straight down. I find with the water tank heater option that I was using before, it would get kind of like liquid get stuck in there. I'd always have to tip my bucket. Whereas this, because it comes straight down, it's a lot more convenient. So you want to get something that will drill big enough to fit this. It's 1 inch is what this comes down to. So I use the stepper bit, but like I said, you could use a drill bit if you can get one big enough. However, with the stepper bit, I do find it makes a really nice edge. And this edge is really easy to seal because there's no jagged ends. And it is, I want to make sure it's showing up on camera. It is really nice and clean. So the clean cut is a little bit better for sealing. This isn't under like any sort of like heavy pressure or anything like that. It's just, I do find that they can leak if this is torn up too much. So next, what you want to do is your barrel tap will come with some O-rings. They'll be like the metal O-ring, the plastic, two of each. Now, for it looking pretty, I'm putting the metal O-ring on here, but I don't think you necessarily would. Again, it's not under intense pressure. It's under literally very little pressure, and there's not very often that there's a ton of liquid in here, which is another reason why you want to try to get this as close to the bottom as possible. This is literal millimeters. Like if I stick my finger in here, it touches the bottom. If I could, I would have even gone lower than that. The lower, the better, because you're not going to end up with a ton of liquid in here. So I make this pretty snug. So you do have to turn it in. If you can just slide it in, you might have some leakage. Not that it's a huge deal, but it can be a little bit gross. If the tap is not in your budget, the other option to this would be to have a bucket where you have holes in the bottom of the first bucket, and then you'd have the top bucket on top. So Lee Valley has the 5 gallon, and then they have, I believe it's a 3 gallon, so it's a half of this. The 3 gallon would be all you would need to fit on the bottom. And I believe the interior, like the ID on it, the interior diameter, is the same as that would fit this. So you would drill holes in the bottom of your 5 gallon pail bucket. You would stick it on top of your 3 gallon bucket, and you would just allow the juice to flow into the 3 gallon pail bucket, and then you would remove and dump as you see fit or as you want to use it. And we'll talk about using the actual tea from this container a little bit later on. But yeah, so that's what you want to do there. If you use the 3 gallon pail bucket or another 5 gallon pail bucket underneath, duct tape it around the edges every time. Again, you want little to no oxygen in this entire system. So next, I'm going to take my plastic rubber ring. I'm going to put my metal ring on the outside, and then I have my nut here. I'm going to make it so this plastic is against the bucket. If the metal is against the bucket, you will get leakage. It won't, because it's on a curve, it won't necessarily stick up very nicely. And depending on how tight I can get this, I may have to use some wrenches. But if I can't get this on there tight enough, and I find that this ring isn't actually bending to the bucket enough, I may remove these metal rings altogether, but we'll see what happens. So while I'm getting this on there, I'm just gonna read some more questions that you guys have. Little off topic, are you able to put this in my Red Wiggler bin? Ant killer dust, silicon dioxide, or will this kill my worms due to other chemicals? So the diatomaceous earth, silicon dioxide, Lower Mainland BC Barb, hello. And you're doing this to eliminate mites. So my first question for you, Michael, is what color are your mites? Are they red or are they white or are they a different color? If they're red or white, then welcome them with open arms. They're actually a part of your worm bin process. I like to think of worm bins, and we actually just did a workshop on vercompost. I like to think of worm bins as mini ecosystems. So people think, All I want in my worm bin is worms. But the reality is, it's basically you're bringing the outdoors inside. So you actually want to welcome everything, including those decomposers that are mites. Now, if they're spider mites, they're kind of like a brownish, light-colored blonde almost. That is of concern. And if you do have that, what I would urge you to do is actually get predatory mites. There's a Canadian company called... Oh my goodness. Grub grenade. That's what it's called. Grub grenade. It has a little brown mite with a World War II helmet on its head. They're actually located out in BC. And they have predatory mites that will eat your harmful mites that may show up in your vermicompost. So I would aim for that. There isn't much out there data-wise to suggest that diatomaceous earth will harm worms and or mites. So there's really no point in even using that method, in my opinion. And the ant killer, I would look for the Nemonites product. And there is a one specific for ants. If they are predatory nematodes, and they will eat all your ants, eggs, that sort of thing, that may show up in your Veracast. If your worm compost bin has ants, it's likely to dry though as well. So you may want to add some water in there too. But yeah, let me know what color those mites are, Michael, because that's gonna make a big difference. So, ta-da! The tap is on there, and if I can do it, you can do it too. So I am the klutziest person ever. So this is what it looks like. It's actually kind of pretty, I'm not gonna lie, but yeah. And then you literally put this gamma lid on top, and you're done. So when it comes to filling the actual bucket, there is a specific way to do this. You want to put your food in every single day or 3 days, whatever the case is. You put it in, and then you're going to want to take a plastic bag and put it over your hand, or you want to get the screens that you put in the microwave to protect your food. So you have the plate of food and it has like a dome over top of it. Flip that over and literally lean into your Bokashi bucket and stomp it. So you want to make sure it is completely flat. There is little to no airspace in it, if at all possible. And then you're going to put a generous layer of the Bokashi bran mix on top. So you can do a cup, you can do a half cup, but if you want really good results, the more, the better. So if you can cover it up to the point that you cannot see any food in there, that is ideal. Ideal. And like I said, every single time you add more food into this, you want to stomp it down with, I use just a plastic bag. So I literally put a plastic bag on my hand and I just like take my hands and I push into all the corners and I push the center and I just keep on patting it down around all the sides until it's really squashed in. And then I will add my Bokashi to the top of that. And I will leave the bag in place. So I just leave the bag on top of the Bokashi, lay it out nice and flat, put my lid on and let it sit. And once you get the entire bucket filled up, you seal it off and you let it sit for 2 weeks. In that 2 weeks time, what you can do is you will get some liquid that may show up at the bottom. So you can drain this off and actually use it for fertilizer, either with your houseplants or with your garden. Now, if you are using organic fertilizer, so if you've mixed in things like Varicast compost manures into your soil, whether that be a potting soil indoors or an outdoor soil, if you top dress with any of this stuff, or if you're just using things like bone meal or blood meal, any sort of organic fertilizer in your garden, this is hugely beneficial because all that liquid in there, it has your EMF, basically all the bacteria that help decompose all the stuff in the bucket. is also going to be present in the juice. So when we add it to our house plants, our seedlings, our outdoor plants, we will end up with a blast of microbes, kind of similar to what the expensive inoculants a lot of us purchase can be. And so when we water our plants with that, we end up helping with nutrient cycling and ultimately better release of nutrients, both nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, you name it. So when it comes to doing that, I do want to get exact measurements here because I don't want to screw this up if someone hurt their plants. So I do have it written down somewhere. Liquid. So it's 1 teaspoon for every 2 to 3 liters of water for using in the actual compost or to use in the soil directly. For trees and shrubs, you can use 2 teaspoons for every 2 to 3 liters. So you can use a little bit more for trees and shrubs. And you never want to apply it directly to the foliage because it is acidic. It is an acidic product after it's done. It's literally fermenting and pickling it. So it will burn your leaves. And then it says around the house, you can use this. You can pour the juice directly into your kitchen or bathroom drains if you just don't want to use it. Or you can use it in your toilets or septic systems. And this is because it has decomposing microbes in it. So if you have a septic system or if you have clogged pipes, it's actually a really organic way to consume or eat any of the gunk in the piping, which is kind of funny. So you can just pour it directly in there as such. And you can put it in your dog waste bin too if it's getting stinky outdoors. So it's completely natural. It's not going to harm any critters in the water systems outdoors. When you use the Bokashi juice or tea out of the actual bucket itself, it's actually much more eco-friendly than something that would, you know, eat away, what is it, CLR or Drano or whatever. This is a much more natural method that you could use. And like I said, you could use this in with houseplants. And for that one, you would do the 1 teaspoon to every 2 to 3 liters. And you can do breads, fruits and vegetables, fish and meats, cooked or raw. You can do cheese, eggs, tea bags, coffee grounds, wilted flowers, tissue paper, like paper towel, Kleenex, that sort of thing. You can do like cardboard and stuff like that, but I find that depending on how dry it is, you put a lot of like cardboard or newspaper into here, it can soak up a lot of your liquid. So if your goal is to get some sort of tea out of it, you'd want to eliminate absorbing factors as much as possible. And then what you cannot put in is plastics, paper, so white paper that you write on or loose leaf, water, juice, or milk. And milk, juice, and water is not specifically that those can't go in. It's that that excess is going to cause like a really goopy mess in here. It's probably going to clog your tap. So if you have milk, dairy products, like in a pasta, for example, maybe you made like a pesto pasta and had some sort of milk in it, that can be composted. That's not the issue. It's the liquid in particular that is the problem. One thing to note is these will get moldy. So when I first started doing my Bokashi composting, some Bokashi troubleshooting here, if you have gray or green mold, that kind of looks fuzzy, that means that you aren't fully sealed. So that means your top isn't on correctly or you're not packing properly and then leaving the plastic on top. You want white and fuzzy. If there's any sort of mold in there, it should be white and fuzzy. It shouldn't be green, blue, or it kind of looks gray to me, but people say blue. It looks gray to me. maybe I'm colorblind. So you want to avoid that whenever possible. It doesn't mean that the compost is bad and you can't throw it in your garden. You can still throw it into your garden. The issue is just that it's not done 110%. So you may not be maximizing your benefits per se. So when you're done after 2 weeks, like I said, you can pour it into like a larger sized Rubbermaid container, or you can dig a hole outside in your garden, your flower bed, or you can actually put it in the bottom of your potted plants if you have a larger size pot, and you will pour your Bokashi compost into that and you will cover it back over. Now, it's not going to look like compost. It is going to look exact same way you had it in there. So don't get discouraged if it doesn't look like a beautiful Labrecque or something that just came hot off the press compost wise. It's going to look identical to how you put it in, but it's going to smell pickled or almost like apple cider vinegar is what it smells like to me. And it's going to have each individual piece you're visually going to be, you're going to see. But the important thing to remember is that all those pieces of organic material are now covered in microbes. And so when we dig our hole in our yard, if we dig a trench, which is my favorite way of doing it, the more you can spread it out, the better. And we put all our compost in, we cover it back over. It will be decomposed 2 to 3 weeks very easily in Canada. And that's where this sets it apart compared to a regular compost as well. With hot compost, it tends to take, you know, 2-3 months to compost the initial pile. And then it's around 2 to 3 months of curing, which means what you start for compost in the winter and spring won't be ready until the fall. And quite honestly, for most of us Canadians, compost we start this year will not be viable fertilizer until next. Whereas with the Bokashi system, it's 2 to 3 weeks max, and what you plant out there in the spring is likely going to be already decomposed and gone by the time you actually go to transplant. So the moment the ground starts de-thawing, you can throw this in and it will begin to be eaten away. So it's really, really convenient and fun, but there are some questions. So I'm just gonna move over. Oh, Wanda from Facebook. Hello from Halifax, Nova Scotia. I'm learning so much. Thank you. Can't wait to get started. Awesome. 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 Yeah. So let me know if you guys have any questions about the Bokashi compost. Like I said, that's kind of why we're going to do the compost accelerator next end of the month here. I believe, I can't remember, Leanne may have to, I want to say it's March 28th. But it might not be March 28th, where we're actually going to do this, because the more of this you put on, the better. It makes a huge, huge difference when it comes to actual composting itself. And like I said, if you have like houseplants in particular, people are starting to go more and more organic with their products, especially when it comes to fertilizer and that sort of thing. And the issue is with a really closed system, like a houseplant system with our potted plants and stuff, is that we end up with not enough moisture. And so we don't end up with necessarily decomposition taking place. So if we let our potted plants dry out, we're technically killing off or slowly whittling away at our microbes in that soil or that potting soil, so we don't end up with as much nutrient cycling, so our plants end up being a little bit starved for nutrients. So if we water with like the Bokashi tea, for example, then we end up re-kickstarting that cycle, and we end up with actual nutrient cycling, which is a huge deal. It means that our organic fertilizers are actually going to work in a potted houseplant scenario. And we won't end up with the nutrient deficiencies that we may see in other cases. The other thing to keep in mind is things like bones and eggs and meat being decomposted in here or in the Bokashi system is a big deal. So when we do regular eggs or regular bones, which you can't really do in a hot composting system, all the calcium ends up still being tied up in its initial form. It takes time for microbes to break it down and make it bioavailable. But with the Bokashi system, we actually get to see those benefits sooner on. So we end up getting that calcium, iron release, a lot of those micronutrients that we have. There's 17 essential plant nutrients out there, many of which aren't in actual available nutrients. And then if you are brave enough to actually compost pet fecal matter, there's a ton of sulfur in there. So if you are gardening with brassica species, mustards, onions, garlics, leeks, that sort of thing, manure. It's a really, really great additive because it's really high in sulfur. And what I like to do to speed this up, and my worms don't eat enough of it for it to happen quickly enough, but I have switched my worms over to a Bokashi system. So they do eat the Bokashi compost before they eat regular compost. It took me about 4 to 6 weeks to flip them over. It's a gradual process because it is relatively acidic, so it can harm them. But once you adjust them slowly, they get used to it. And I find that my turnover rate in organic material is much, much quicker. So I pretty much have a continual supply of basically potting soil at my disposal at all times. And that is because, remember, vermicompost, I believe, is a complete microbial system. It's its own little ecosystem that doesn't just include worms, but includes mites and obviously bacteria, fungi, that sort of thing, which is what is present in this. So got lots and lots and lots of questions. March 31st, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That is when we're going to do the Bokashi DIY. Since this is an anaerobic composting, is there methane released? No. So it doesn't smell. Methane gas that you usually smell, like if you go near a compost heap, you can kind of smell that. It's very aromatic. Almost. It doesn't smell bad. It just is aromatic. That is like a gas release. Manure, if you have manure composting, you can smell that. It's very obvious that what's going on there, that's maybe sulfuric, more so smell than methane particularly. But your Bokashi compost should never stink. That's why it can be done indoors. And that's why it can be done in buckets. So even when you take the top off of this, it should not smell. Mine doesn't smell. Mine's in the basement. At most, it'll smell like pickles, or what I think it smells like is apple cider vinegar. And so some people say pickles or like a vinegar mix, but I personally think it smells like apple cider vinegar. So it should not smell. If it smells, it's a sign that you're not using enough of the Bokashi bran. So you actually want to pour more into the mixture, and or you're exposing the bucket to air. So really make sure your gamma lid is really pushed on nice and firm, and that O-ring isn't crinkled or anything like that, and it is completely sealed shut. So that's very, very important. Luis is asking, can you put this into a regular compost outdoors? Will it hurt our red wiggler worms? So Luis, you can put this into a regular compost. It isn't obviously a C to N ratio maybe that you're looking for, but you would treat this as the green matter of it. So your leaves would be your brown matter. This would be the green matter, and it's going to decompose very, very quickly in a composting situation. For sure, especially in a hot composting situation, it's going to disappear very, very quickly. So if you technically wanted to expedite the composting process, you would add the bucket to the Bokashi, the bucket of Bokashi to your compost, and it would expedite the process. I wouldn't waste my money in that case on a separate accelerator. So like this right here, I'm just gonna close this because this, you guys, anyone who Bokashi compost knows what smelling. So, but the actual compost accelerator per se is essentially what's in here at that point. But this is a lot more potent. So I wouldn't waste my money on any compost accelerators. If you're using the Bokashi in a regular compost system, just throw your regular Bokashi bin into the compost in and of itself. So, will it hurt your red wiggler worms? So it's not going to hurt your red wiggler worms in a big overarching situation. So it's not going to hurt your red wigglers in your garden or in your yard on a large scale, because there's so much surface area. There's so many different crevices and stuff for the acidity to spread out and move through and that sort of thing. So it's not going to hurt it if it's a large landscape. But if we're talking a closed red wiggler system, yes, it will hurt your red wigglers if you don't ease them into Bokashi. So once you go red wiggler Bokashi, you kind of have to stay there. You can't hop back and forth. You got to have a Bokashi red wiggler bin, and that is it, because you do have to adjust that pH. You have to get them used to a more acidic environment. So just keep that in mind. Like I said, I converted mine over, and all I did is I had a Bokashi bin, and it's one cup. So you put a cup in one little section of the bin, and you don't, you know, water it in, you don't dig it in, you just place it around on top. You wait till all that is eaten while still feeding them their regular food kind of in the other areas. And then as you see that eaten, you add another cup, and then you just watch them, and they slowly, faster and faster, will eat away at the Bokashi side of things. And then you just kind of up the ante over time. And like I said, this decomposes or is eaten much quicker than that of just a regular organic material. So Eric on Facebook, is the tea ruined if it's froze? So that's a really good question, Eric. Bacteria, the fungi, spores, I'm not worried about, because fungi, spores will survive our climate change. They'll survive everything. So I'm not worried about the fungal spores. I'm more so worried about the bacteria, which is kind of what makes Bokashi what it is that EMF bacteria. So that would be my concern. Now, in a large majority of cases, bacteria doesn't die when it's frozen. It just really slows down in its replication. So if you chose to freeze it, you would just be slowing down the bacteria for a temporary period of time. But keep in mind, if you freeze it for a year or two or three, you're slowly going to start decreasing the viability of the bacteria in there, because they're still alive, but they're just not eating, right? So, and that's just kind of the way to look at that. If you put it in the fridge, for example, say you're not producing enough on your own Bokashi tea-wise, and you wanted to put it in the fridge because you're getting way more than maybe a teaspoon, and you don't have nearly enough plants to water that tea with, you could drain it into a mason jar and then place that mason jar in the fridge with a sealed lid. And that isn't going to slow them down enough that it's going to harm anything, but it will slow down their replication process, making it a more viable product. So I would prefer you did cold, dark area first and foremost. And then if you could do a fridge, that would be my second choice. My third would be the actual freezer in and of itself. But again, the freezer is not going to hurt anything. So if you did ice cubes, and say just for convenience sake, you filled up an ice cube tray and each one was a teaspoon or two teaspoons, and you knew you took the ice cube out, put it in a 3-liter jug, and that was your water, that will work. There's no reason why it won't. So definitely, definitely. Kristen is asking, what would the best way to use it in conjunction with worm compost? Is there a DIY option for the bran? Yeah, so Kirsten, you're asking if you can use it with the worm compost. Yes, you can. Like I said, a cup at a time, and just treat it normally, like let them eat away at it. There's less liquid with the bokashi once it's done. So you wouldn't be feeding it to your worms until it's done being eaten. And so when you go to use it, it's going to be drier. So you will need, maybe notice you have to water your vermicompost bin more often. And another thing too, if you have your worm bin, I find personally, because I treat my vermicompost bins, and like, go watch the last workshop we did where we did vermicompost, and you'll note that I could constantly talk about it being an ecosystem. I actually add my bokashi bran to my worm bin. So your worms will eat the bran, but the bran will also help decompose everything in that system. It's really going to reduce smell in and of itself, and it's just going to help with the process. You don't need much, but just, you know, a handful every once in a while, I do find helps just with the bin in general and make it so that I get varicast much, much sooner. So something to keep in mind there. And then, is there a DIY option for the bran? Yes, there is. And we are going to be doing that video March 31st at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We'll be here. Go sign up. It's already over on Facebook, so you can sign up now. And I'll be walking you through all the steps on how to do that. And yeah, so that will be available for you guys to watch. So Rita on Facebook is asking, is the bokashi compost still viable if it freezes? If I throw it into the raised bed throughout the winter to disperse it into the soil, when it thaws, will there still be plenty of microbes? Yeah, so Rita, great question. And it kind of goes back to the same, similar question to what, who was asking, Eric was asking. So yes, I can throw mine in the backyard. I throw mine on the garden all the time. It decomposes just as quickly as it normally would, but just keep in mind that you're going to have to maybe dig the snowbank out a bit, because you're going to have to eventually dig that in. This isn't a heat producing product, so it doesn't get hot like a hot compost or a regular compost would. It stays relatively cool, so it's not going to melt through the snow. You'd have to make an area for it to dig it in and under. But yeah, your microbes will survive the freeze. It's the concern would be if you were to freeze it for extended periods of time. Like I'm talking, if you froze it for 2-3 years type thing, that would be more so the concern rather than the bin being dumped outdoors and then it thawing in a few months. That's not so much the issue. So yeah, absolutely, you can do that. Betty on Facebook, in-home vermicompost versus in-bed vermicompost versus bokashi. I was thinking the easiest would be sink a bucket with holes in my raised bed and throw compost material in it for my worms already in my raised bed. I'm looking for the easiest solution. Yeah, I love that question, Betty, because that's actually what got me into the bokashi and the vermicompost systems, was because I was looking for an easy solution. I had hot compost. I live in Saskatchewan. I'm in Saskatoon, actually. It's zone 3 here, and it's a cold zone 3, and it's a zone 3 that only has like 106 growing days. Like it's very short season. We have a grand total of basically 3 months that we can grow food in. So with composting, that means it's just nearly impossible to get a compost to do much here, just because of that. So I, for years, was just trying so many different solutions to this, and this is the system that I came down to. So I'm using the bokashi in the winter more so than anything, because I have mice and frozen compost piles. It's not my idea of fun. So I've been using bokashi for an indoor system. And then initially what I was doing is I was just throwing it into my raised beds in the winter and letting it freeze up. And then I would dig a hole and I would dig it into the trench and I would put the bokashi compost in and I would cover it over. That's kind of what I did for a very long time. But then I started getting into the worms. And now I've switched the worms over to eating the Bokashi compost. So I'm not running outdoors and dumping this in the snowbank anymore. My worms are what is eating it. And I find that that two-part system is incredibly convenient for me. So you could do you do PVC pipe. I've seen people do it with laundry baskets before too. I've seen people do it with milk jugs, you name it. You cut the top off, you dig a hole, you drill some holes into it, and then you place it in, and then you put all your food scraps into that, and then the worms will come and go out of your container that you have in your soil. Sounds beautiful. And it works very, very well if you have worms. Not everyone has worms, and that's not your fault. Worms are not a sign of a healthy soil in Canada. It's actually a sign that your landscape was pulverized by glaciers. When the glaciers moved across North America, they were very, very heavy and they squashed out all the earthworms. So there's vast areas of Canada, actually North America, that don't have any actual native earthworms. And the earthworms you do find are technically one of the 19 species brought over by European gardeners. So in Canada, contrary to what a lot of the UK influencers, garden influencers, or what the Californian influencers will say, in Canada, earthworms aren't a sign of a healthy soil. So that's just something to keep in mind there. Don't get discouraged if you do the PVC pipe method, hoping to encourage earthworms, and you don't see any, you're not doing anything wrong. It's just very, very natural process that happens. So do what you like, do what suits you best. If you do the PVC or some sort of container in the ground and you're letting worms go back and forth, have a cover for it. Mice will enjoy that just as equally. And the reason for the Bokashi for me is the fact that it will do the dairy. So it will do the cheese, it will do the milk, it will do the sour cream, and it will do bones. It will do fish scales, fish fins, it will do a wide range of chicken bones, that sort of thing. And we eat lots of fish in our house. We fish here in Saskatchewan all the time. So it's very, very convenient in that sense. And we have animals too. So being able to put my birds' bedding and stuff into here, also very, very convenient. We're running out of time here. So I'm going to just run through this. I have 3 minutes, guys. Okay. Mark from PEI, great video. Do anaerobic microbes struggle in an aerobic environment? Yes, they do heavily. They have their roles and they like to stick to them. Good news is that aerobic is what we're aiming for in hot compost, and anaerobic is what we're aiming for in Bokashi compost. And aerobic bacteria and soil is ideal for plants. Anaerobic is not, because one of our favorite anaerobic microbes out there is the microbe that is responsible for, drumroll please, root rot. So if you have root rot, it means you have an anaerobic soil and that bacteria is thriving and enjoying your plant roots at the same time. Marin on Facebook, I have little white mites kill the red worms in the indoor bare composting setup. I just insulated my worm bin and now have red worms outside. So she's saying that she has little white mites that are harming her worms in her vermicompost setup. So she's put an insulated bin outdoors. You should look at predatory mites for your bin. In Canada, the brand is called Grub Grenade. I keep on forgetting. I use that product all the time too. Grub Grenade is the product name. It's Canadians out of BC. I don't know if they ship to the US though, so find maybe someone in the US that you can ship to. Kids Creation on Twitch says, hi, it's been a minute. I haven't heard from you in the last couple lives here. Denise on Facebook, how long do you store your Bokashi in a Tupperware to compost outdoors? All winter. I do months. I literally do months. I seal it up. And then every time I go to add like a new bin to my Rubbermaid, I'll open it up, look inside, see what's going on, give it a little bit of a sniff. And if it smells rotten or gross, I will just add more Bokashi bran and seal it back up. Or I will just double check, make sure there's no liquid in the bottom. So that may just involve using a spade and like shifting everything over and kind of dumping it and seeing. For the most part though, if you've been draining it for the 2 weeks that it was sitting in this bucket, there should not be much left liquid wise. You should have gotten a lot of it off, especially if you're doing that process I explained at the beginning where we're really pushing stuff down, which is very, very, very important. So I think that's all we have for questions. Lee Valley's gonna be so proud of me. I didn't go over time. I literally ended at exactly 7 o'clock. I'm so proud of myself right now. That's very rare. I usually like talk way more than this. So no, that's good. So join us. We have one between me and the DIY Bokashi compost. We have Monstera. It's a houseplant one. Lee Valley. Okay, here we go. Thank you for joining us tonight. We'll be back with two live streams, Friday, March the 18th at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and then Saturday, March 19th at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. Make sure you guys go sign up for those over on the Lee Valley Facebook. If you sign up on Lee Valley Facebook and you want to watch it on YouTube or Twitch, the Lee Valley Facebook sign up, it's just a really nice way for Lee Valley to know you're showing up, as well as giving you a little reminder to actually show up. So be sure to sign that up. And yeah, so Saturday is the modern Monstera. So that's houseplants and spring plant refresh. So that's what it's going to be called. It'll be a good time. So all you plant folks, go show her your love and support. I believe she's in Ontario, if I'm not wrong. But yeah, if you guys have any other questions, just pop them down in the comments down below over on the Facebook, and I will go check those out tonight, answer the rest of them as they come up. But enjoy the very, very near future spring, and I will definitely talk to you guys next time. Bye.